Hello and welcome. I'm Rich Comet, Senior Vice President, Chief of Staff at ACP. We're excited to continue our Inside Look series with our friends from BNP Paribas. The title of today's session is So You Want to Be a Trader, and I'm curious to learn more about what it takes to be a trader, but I know BNP also doesn't just offer one kind of career, but a whole multitude of opportunities from client relations to data science, financial analysis, digital transformation, and so much more. So also, these careers are constantly evolving to ensure that they can meet and exceed the expectations of clients, their staff, and society. At BNP, they are committed to being a leader in sustainable finance, and they've been a partner with us for 2 years now. And I'll tell you, I've been to their New York City office, and everyone I have met up to their CEO are super dedicated to supporting the military community. So we really appreciate their partnership. I want to remind everybody that if this will be videotaped and posted on our LinkedIn. So if you want to watch it again or share with your friends, please do. If you have any questions, please put that in the chat and we'll get to them a little bit later in the broadcast. So continue to watch and share and look for more of these opportunities as we go. So now I'm going to turn it over to Lena to introduce herself and then Jeremy to start off our conversation about how to be a trader.
Hi, everyone. Rich and the ACP, thank you so much for having us. My name is Lena Carollo. I have been with the firm for 2 years. I'm a vice president and I head up the talent acquisition strategic sourcing team. And I'm passionate about building best-in-class recruiting diversity processes for the organization, raise cultural awareness, celebrate our differences and advocate for inclusion. I strive and I'm committed to these initiatives that will essentially attract, hire, and retain military talent as well as talent of all underrepresented groups. And I'll turn it over to Jeremy Rosen.
Thanks, Lena. So my name is Jeremy Rosen. I tried to change my name on the screen to J-Ro because that's what everybody calls me on the trading floor, but I'm comfortable either way. I've been at BNP for 15 years. I graduated Cornell in 2000. A little bit later, I'm going to ask you to guess what my major was at Cornell. So we're going to make this interactive at the end. And, you know, we always like folks to be confident and take some initiative and some risks. So when we get to the Q&A, I'm gonna ask you to guess my major, but I've been in the industry for over 20 years, always in a trading capacity. I'm here to share some of my insights today. I know that trading has this perception that there's these great barriers to entry, but I hope over this next 45 minutes or so, I could debunk some of the myths, talk about how some of your skills might actually translate well to a career in trading. And look, what I want to say before we even get started is I don't come from a military family, but all I can say is that I'm incredibly grateful for your service and, you know, for the protection and the freedom that you provide. When we're fortunate enough, folks like me and my peers, to have the careers and the lives that we have because of your service, we want to do everything we can to say thank you. And also to create opportunities in the civilian world where, you know, your skills can be really useful, whether you know it or not. So with that, I think we should get started. I'm here, Rich, if you have any questions for me to get going.
Yeah, let's get into this. So 15 years is a while. So I would think with that experience that you might have an idea on how to tell whether someone would be good at doing trading because, the people watching this probably have no experience being a trader, but they may be interested in it. So how would you be able to, pick out someone that would be a good trader?
Okay, well, usually I take someone from the audience, but they told me there's a little bit of a delay, so I'm gonna pick on you, all right? I'm gonna ask you a question. Do you have any friends?
At least one or two, yes.
You have friends, you have a couple of friends, okay? What do you do with your friends?
And go out to eat, go watch concerts, okay. Whatever else, yeah.
Okay, go out to dinner. Is it safe to say you and a group of friends go out to dinner sometime?
Yes.
All right. Now, think about this. Does someone in your group, that same group of friends, it may be you, it may be someone else, does someone in that group typically drive the decision of what restaurant to go to?
Yes.
Okay, is it you?
If my wife lets me, yes.
Okay. Okay. Let's say it's your wife. All right. Now, your wife is the person who picks where you go to dinner with your group of friends. All right. Now, let's assume it is an amazing night. You have great service, great food. The energy in the room is fantastic. The bill comes. It's less than you expected. At the end of the night, your wife is the hero. Is that safe to say?
For sure. And that's usually how it happens in case she's watching.
In case she watches the replay. All right. So on that evening, she, just like a trader, is wearing the risk of the outcome of that evening. And that risk is going to affect her because it's going to mean whether or not she had a good experience, but also the risk of everybody else in the party. Okay. If it's a great night, well, I'm sorry, what's your wife's name?
Jennifer.
All right. If it's a great night, everybody says Jennifer's the hero. And next time we go out to dinner, let her pick because she did a fantastic job. Now, let's assume, and I know this is a very unlikely scenario, let's assume Jennifer picks a dinner reservation and you get there and your table's not ready. And then when you sit down, you're right next to the kitchen and the door is banging on somebody and pissing them off all night. And then the server messes up the meal. And then the bill comes at the end and it's twice as much as you expected. All right.
Sounds like I made the decision.
Well, okay. So that, let's say you made the decision that night. So are you, what happens? Are you the hero or are you the villain?
Yeah. No one lets me pick a restaurant ever again. No,
you're the villain. And you know what I say to people, again, I know this audience is a lot of folks that don't have a ton of, you know, quote unquote trading experience, whether you believe it or know it or not, people may have inherently the ability to be good or not so good traders. And, you know, go back to Jennifer. What would cause her to pick a good restaurant? She's going to read reviews. She's going to maybe go on the website. She's going to maybe talk to friends and ask them, have you been to this place? What was it like? Whatever. All that is gathering information and then making a decision. All right. That's exactly what we do on the desk. All trading is taking information that's public, right? If it was non-public information, then we couldn't trade on it. It's public information, it's gathering it, it's coming to a decision, and then taking risk, taking that risk. It's not, people think sometimes trading, taking risks, oh, they've got to be skydivers or whatever. You could take very calculated risks, just like a restaurant. And
you know, that's right along with, I think, every job in the military. Really, as you were saying that, I was thinking, you know, from being, a driver that has to make sure what their vehicle is ready to go, a mechanic, someone that is, whether they're going to shoot at something or not shoot at something, whether you're a squad leader, every one of those positions out there has those type of analyses and then decision making. So,
and that's why, yep. And that's why I'm here today to just talk about the fact that I'm sure a lot of folks on this call, if you're nodding your head, if you're the person that's like, I don't like to make the restaurant pick, I don't want everybody to be mad at me, I don't want it, then you know that's good. You're learning about yourself. But if you're nodding your head and you're saying, wow, that's just like me, then that's a good first start that you might be, you know, positioned for a successful career in trading.
And then we'll ask Nina to comment on some of those other types of jobs if trading isn't the thing later on.
Okay, perfect.
Sounds good.
I'm not done.
All right, my bad.
We're not done. So what did we decide? That Jennifer is wired to be a trader and you're not. No, only kidding. Now, I'm going to ask you, I live on the Jersey Shore. It's a beautiful day. I live near the beach. So I always often ask people, when do you think I take my family to the beach? Under what like conditions? Weather, what day of the week, what part of the year?
When no one else is there. Or you must know the secrets because you don't want to be with the crowds and stuff.
So that's good. So you're already learning from some of the insights from from our first conversation. So I just because we're you know, I want to be respectful of the time, and I know we have a lot to go after. Oftentimes when I ask people this question, when do you think I go to the beach? The answer is on Saturday in August when it's 80 degrees and sunny, okay? Because that's a quote-unquote Jersey Shore beach day. Well, even though I live 8 miles from the beach, What do you think happens on the Saturday in August when it's 80 degrees and sunny?
There's a lot of people there.
I hit traffic. It takes 1 hour to go 8 miles. It takes 1 hour to park. By the time you get to the beach, if you find just enough sand to put your towel down, you're lucky. And it's a terrible experience. So then I say, okay, well, what about the flip side? Do you think I go on a rainy day in January? Of course not. A rainy day in January, it's cold and it's uncomfortable. So when does J-Ro take his family to the beach? Well, just like we talked about the restaurant review, I'm certainly not a weatherman, but the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to find a day that's 50% chance of rain. Because a 50% chance of rain also means a 50% chance of sunshine, right? Then we're going to look at, my phone and see, oh, maybe the storm is moving a little bit north, or maybe the storm's going a little bit south. And if the storm, in my opinion, is going a little bit north, then I'm going to choose a beach a little bit south on a day that has a 50% chance of rain and a 50% chance of sunshine, because typically, you know, the weather report will talk about the whole region and not necessarily the areas. And if we take that risk and we drive 1 hour south and we go to the beach and the sun goes out, there will be no traffic, there will be no trouble parking, there will be no crowds on the beach, and we'll have a perfectly wonderful day. And just like Jennifer in the first example, I'm the hero, okay? What happens if we do all this and the skies open up?
Then you're in trouble.
I got upset children. I got an upset wife. I'm aggravated. And by the way, just so you know, these emotions are exactly the same as when we put trades on, okay? The same decision-making, whether a storm is going to go north or a storm is going to go south, deciding, you know, when we think the crowds are going to be there or not. This is all what we do. We collect information and then we take a risk. And if you take the risk and you buy something and it goes up, it's the same as taking your family to the beach and having, you know, the clouds disappear and the sun go out. And if the skies open up and rain, then, you know, it's exactly the same as, you know, taking a position and having it go against you.
So after I hear this, I'm still 50-50 here. I'm on the fence on whether I want to be a trader or not. So one thing that's in my mind is, you know, I spent 23 years in the Army, and, you know, sometimes it's pretty stressful. And I'm wondering, you know, how stressful is this job? Am I going to go from one stressful job to another stressful job? You know, is there a way to manage that stress? I just want to know.
That's a great question. It's often asked of me, and this is the way I explain it. Do you like sports?
Yes.
What's your favorite sport?
Probably football.
Or your team. Okay, who's your team?
Mostly college stuff now. I have to say West Point Army, of course.
All right, let's say West Point. Let's say West Point, okay? Army Navy. Let's say the Army Navy game.
Oh, now you're bringing it up a notch.
Yeah. Okay. But I want you to feel the pressure of what I feel. When you're at the Army Navy game and it's tie score and Army's down by six with the ball and they're driving. Are you stressed?
Yes. A lot. My seat.
Is it good stress? Is it fun stress? Is it bad stress?
If they're driving, it's good stress.
Exactly. So, and how about when they score? How does that feel?
That's amazing.
It's an amazing feeling. So the way I like to explain it, and not everybody's a sports fan on the call. So I also say, like, if you like movies that have, you know, a lot of drama, you don't know if the person's the hero or the villain, and you don't know what the twist is going to be at the end. You know, that's stress. And do we feel it every day? Of course I feel it. I feel like I wanted to be a professional athlete. That was my dream. God didn't give me the body to be a professional athlete, but I do feel like every day I'm playing a professional sport, because you have the emotional highs and the emotional lows. You have a bad morning and you feel like you threw a pick six. You have a great afternoon and you feel like, you know, you just took over the lead. Every day you have P&L. So that's like the score at the end of the day. Every month you have, you know, your monthly P&L standings. That's kind of like how your team is progressing throughout the year. And at the end of the year, you have a final P&L, which is like, how did you finish? Did you win the championship by having a great year? Did you do terrible and you risk getting relegated? Like, you have a score every single day that tells you. But with, you know, specifically answering your question about stress, the answer is yes, it's stressful, but I like it. It's stress that I like. Would you like to live in a world where there was no Army-Navy game? Or would you prefer to live in a world where every year you get to deal with those emotions?
All right, I think you're selling me a little, you're pushing me over the edge a little bit more. I do like that. I do enjoy that. Those are good times of stress, yes.
Okay. But just for folks that are totally on the fence, you know, it's emotional. It's an emotional career, but some people enjoy that. I mean, clearly you see, I have passion. Lena, when you hear from her, you can feel the passion in everything she talks about. You know, that's a characteristic of people that typically do well in our industry.
Yeah, and I like the analogy with the sports or the movies because we all can kind of relate. But also, I would think that, you know, for the military, we're usually focused on a mission, right? And to me, you know, this is a different mission, but it's a mission in itself, right? You know what you're going towards. You know what things you need to be shooting to do better. And I think that's, you know, that would resonate with a lot of the people watching this call too. So that's good. All right. So now, although I am a little bit of a science math nerd, not everyone is. I recognize that. So the question I have for you is, you know, do you have to have strong math skills to be a trader?
Thank you for the question. Look, the direction of the industry is certainly focusing on STEM. You know, strong math skills are very helpful, particularly in some of the more technical trading jobs. But I absolutely feel strongly to remind everybody that there are different ways that you could be a trader. And the way, you know, the way I try to explain it is this. You might go on LinkedIn and see somebody works at BNP Paribas and they have a title as trader, okay? And you may have some ideas of what that person's, you know, job might look like. But here I'm going to give you three examples of people with the title of trader that work at BNP, and I'm going to tell you that they get paid the same amount of money. Their P&L for at the end of the year is exactly the same. And as I said, they have exactly the same title, okay? One is a high frequency trader, all right? A high frequency trader might have tens of thousands, maybe 100,000 trades per day, okay? Every second, they are locked into their seat, making sure that all the algorithms are working correctly, that the microscopic index arbitrage is working, and in every one of those tens of thousands of trades, they're collecting fractions of a basis point in order to drive P&L to the platform. And at the end of the year, after they execute, you know, hundreds of millions of trades, perhaps their P&L, I'm just going to throw a number out, is $10 million. And their compensation is, you know, $100. Okay. So that's a high frequency trader, same title, same P&L. And that's one trading role. I do something called Delta One trading. Delta One trading requires, we execute something in the magnitude of 25 to 30 trades per day. Okay. So it requires a lot of attention. For example, I had to, you know, notify my team that I was going to disconnect for this call, but it doesn't require the same attention that the high frequency trader life will have. My title is trader. My P&L is $10 million per year. My compensation is $100, but it requires an incredibly different skill set and frankly, interest than the high frequency trader, which is, you know, that would be a high math STEM, locked into algorithms, watching every split second of the market. A Delta One trader, I'm afforded the opportunity to step away, have conversations like this, meet with clients. And, you know, again, the role is called the same thing, but the job description is quite different. And then the third trader, also same title, same P&L target, same compensation, could be a structured product trader. A structured product trader might execute only 4 to 5 transactions per year, okay? But each one of those trades is a jumbo transaction. Let's say if the P&L is 10 million, five trades of a $2 million P&L per trade. That job requires daily work to come up with this jumbo trade, but don't have the daily transactions that either one of the first two have. But it's also a trading role. So if you're more project-based, if you like a more long-term, perhaps a slower pace, that could be a trading role for you. The important part is there's such a wide spectrum, okay? And that, again, that one of the things that I wanted to talk about on this call is, you know, you may have met a single trader in your life or a handful of traders in your life, but I can't emphasize enough that there are so many different roles that call themselves traders that have different characteristics, and BNP, we have lots of them. So make sure you keep yourself with an open mind to all the different opportunities that are out there.
Yeah, so I wanted to bring Lena into this conversation as a follow-up. So if I'm on the fence on if I want to be that person that's the trader, but I still like what you're talking about, what other type of roles are there at BNP that aren't necessarily trader, but are obviously working in the same, you know, as a member of this team to make all this stuff happen? Lena?
I think we might be having a technical.
Can you guys hear me? Sorry.
Yeah, now
so, well, to your point, well, you know, okay, sorry about that. Well, everyone might not necessarily have, quote unquote, the DNA of a trader or kind of be on the fence. We have, you know, BNP Paribas, we have functions roles, so middle office and back office roles that all play a role in supporting traders, so Jeremy's team. And a lot of the skill sets are extremely transferable and entail things like attention to detail, passion, motivation, the ability to adapt. Even for a role like myself, being in talent acquisition, you have to be motivated, right? There's days where the war for talent can be a little bit discouraging, but you can't let that get you down. Compliance, risk, legal, accounting. I mean, the list goes on and on in terms of various roles that we offer within operations and so forth. Again, all working as a team, which those in, you know, the branches of the military are very familiar with, very well with, could really add value and elevate our workforce and our employees. And again, it's the things that you can't teach, the things you don't necessarily capture on a resume, but it's either you got it or you don't. And, you know, I'm a big believer in veterans and those who serve or who have served, you know, you can do it all. So, you know, don't pigeonhole yourself. And certainly if you're on the fence, ask the questions, you know, reach out to us. Happy to set up conversation with, you know, with J-Ro or someone else that might be, you know, more aligned with what you're looking for in terms of various departments or teams, divisions, things like that. But yeah, my advice is, you know, for me, a resume is a piece of paper. Motivation, the grit, the grind that you all have, that's something you're either got or you don't. And I know the veteran community certainly has it.
Great. Thank you. So kind of along that line, so Jeremy, when you're looking for team members, what qualities do you look for when you're hiring someone on your team?
Well, look, I think first and foremost, I mean, because I totally wholeheartedly agree with all the things that Lena listed in terms of, you know, what skill sets are successful in our industry. I would also caveat that they are successful for many industries. So what the first thing I really like to ask people is, are you passionate about markets? And you may not know whether you are or aren't now, and that's something that you can develop. But, you know, at the end of the day, if you're smart and hardworking and a good quality of character, there's so many industries that you could be successful in. So if you're going to choose finance, trading, sales and trading, global markets, you know, we want people that love markets. And whether you know that or not now isn't a big deal. But over time, if you don't find yourself having the same passion that many of us do, then it's probably not the right industry for you. So, you know, we always want passion for markets. But a lot of the things that Lena mentioned, attention to detail, you know, confidence, people that take initiative. I know this is not a great analogy for this group, because as I said, I don't come from a military family, but, you know, I make a joke that I only hire people that will carry me out of a burning building if I'm passed out. And, you know, that real team mentality is something that, you know, anybody that's spent time with my team knows that we're a family. We back each other up. We care about each other and we're there to help each other. I know that that's very common in the military. So that's not something I would question about anybody in this community. But yeah, definitely, you know, a willingness to roll up your sleeves, calm under pressure. You know, and as we said earlier, these are a lot of the characteristics of the military community, which is why, you know, we're here today to try to encourage more folks to join our industry.
All right. So we have covered a lot about the industry, right? But now I want to know if what you guys are telling me is resonating with me. How do I know if BNP is a place I want to look at as a place of employment? So can you talk a little bit about the culture there? I'll tell you that from my experience, I was invited to an event there in the New York City office, and the culture was amazing. You would never know, you know, on the surface, but when you get in there, the people were super engaging, super helpful, all the way up to the CEO. So I'll say from my experience, it's pretty awesome. But what about, how is it like from working there?
Lena, do you want to take this? I have some thoughts as well.
Sure. So, you know, people will tend to poke fun at me because I bleed green. I think my family is worried I might consider getting the BNP tattoo at some point. But I truly mean it when I say the culture is unparalleled. I mean, people want to see you win. They want to see you grow. It's such a family, as Jeremy mentioned, mentality, and it's a place where people make you feel good, and you never feel like, oh, I gotta go to work tomorrow, or oh, you know, I can't bring this up to my supervisor. It's just a place where, you know, it's truly a team environment, and again, people want to see you grow. They want to see you win. That's how we retain talent, right? People leave people. So the culture, I mean, for me, I've only been with the firm for 2 years, and I've worked for various other corporations. And it is just, it's unparalleled. You know, the firm has done a lot for me and has been extremely flexible, empathetic, and just, again, the word passionate. And for me, it's, you know, it's not a job. It's not a career. It's home.
I tell people that all the time, sometimes we overlook the culture, but I think that's going to make or break whether you want to stay somewhere or, like you said, get up and go to work every morning. So, Jeremy, what do you have to add to the culture there?
Yeah. So thank you for asking the question, because, you know, I started my career at a place called Knight Capital, Knight Trading, and it was a very college-like atmosphere. And I took for granted how wonderful it was, because it was a great place to start my career. Some of the people I met there are still, you know, some of my closest friends. It's where I started my career. So, but at the time, I didn't understand the importance of culture. What I didn't like about that place was I didn't feel as challenged on a day-to-day basis. And I ultimately left there to go to a hedge fund. Now, the hedge fund environment was completely different, because people weren't friendly. People were quite miserable, actually. And there was no team environment. Everybody was sort of out for themselves. And look, I'm not here to say that that's a terrible environment. Some people are well suited for that. But what I learned from that experience was that, you know, I am a team-oriented person. I am a person that likes to you know, help others and really, you know, help the BNP community. And it certainly wasn't valued there, and it certainly wasn't part of that company culture. So I left there, and when I searched for my next place, it was the first time I started having these conversations out loud about, you know, where would I want to park my career for the next, you know, many, many years. And I didn't know much about BNP. You know, it's funny, sometimes we take for granted, especially I've worked there for so long, you know, it's one of the largest banks in the world. Obviously, our headquarters are in Europe, so it's well better known in Europe. But it's a, it's an incredible growing presence here in the U.S. And which, by the way, is now part of our culture, because while some of our peers are getting smaller, BNP in the U.S. is clearly growing. But anyway, when I was having this discussion about where do I want to be, somebody said, oh, BNP is great because it's team oriented. There's a focus on diversity of and inclusion. There's incredibly brilliant people, so you're always going to be challenged. So when I got there, and the other thing, it has a European culture. So, you know, I celebrate differences. And a story that I tell is, you know, I went to a client event where every bank had a different table. And I looked at one of the tables from one of our, you know, US bank competitors. And it was 10 white dudes with the same color suit, with the same color tie, with the same haircut. And they were all talking about, you know, the same topic, whatever. And I looked at the BNP table, and it was like different shapes, sizes, gender, skin color, you know, everything. And it was such a great representation of company culture. And I am not one to say the 10 people who look alike and talk alike and you know, wear the same clothes, I'm not saying one is better than the other, but it was a great living example of how different BNP is from that other place. And it gave me great pride. I run a lot of women's initiatives for women in trading. I think that's an underrepresented group on the trading floor. And as Lena said, it's a very warm and welcoming place. And that is what suits me. And that's why I've been there for so long.
Oh, I think that's great. And I'll tell you that I noticed the same thing when I was there. And the fact that that I was invited to the headquarters in New York City was, you know, again, an example of them being inviting, for sure. All right. So now I'm getting closer to finding a way into getting a job there. So one thing I want to know is where are their jobs located? I know that you have presence in the U.S. and Europe. Is if they go to your job site right now, can they apply for jobs all over? And maybe where are the kind of the major areas?
So we currently have offices in New York City, Jersey City, as well as Chesterbrook, Pennsylvania, very small town in the greater Philadelphia area. Most people align it with King of Prussia Mall, which is a staple of mine. And we also are in the works of building out our office in Miami, which is very exciting. But yeah, if you leverage our career site, as well as our talent community, which both links will be circulated after the event, you'll be able to filter by location to determine, you know, logistically what would be enticing for you, as well as different departments and group functions to explore our openings. If there isn't something currently available, you know, that catches your eye, you know, there is a way for you to set up alerts by appropriate department or buzzwords for you to, you know, revisit. But we welcome the opportunity to have exploratory and introductory conversations. That way, you know, we know what you're looking for. We have an idea of a position that is, you know, coming to fruition in the near future, and can, you know, introduce you to a few members at the firm. Again, like Jeremy said, everyone is so warm and welcoming and is open to speaking and helping anyone advance in their career, you know, hopefully with BNP, but if not, just grow professionally and personally as well. So we're all huge advocates for that. but certainly by visiting our talent community and our career site is where you'll be able to locate those jobs.
Yeah, I think Kayla dropped those in the chat. So if you didn't see them, maybe Kayla, you drop them in there again for us, but they're in there so you can go back and find them. Along with that, I guess, what's the work situation as far as remote versus in-person versus hybrid? Either one of you can comment on that one. I think it's...
Well, you can see both of us are working from home today, so there is a bit of flexibility. I will say that the sands are shifting a bit, particularly on the trading floor. There is a strong push to have traders in the office more often. I personally, I'm a stronger proponent for more flexibility. As I said, I live in the Jersey Shore area, so it's about 3 hours of commuting per day. There's certainly benefits to being in the office in terms of personal interaction. So I would never be in favor of 100% remote. In terms of flexibility, return to office, well, first of all, I will say as a company culture, there's a lot of understanding in terms of, you know, personal family leave. I know we have a great maternity and paternity policy. There's always, you know, an understanding if you have something personal. The reason I'm home today is I'm taking my daughter to a gymnastics competition in Virginia Beach tonight. So it's, you know, there's always a good acceptance of flexibility. But, you know, specifically for traders, the desire is to have traders in the office more often than some of the other positions.
All right. So I'm starting to get some questions that are coming up in the chat that I wanted to address. And please, anybody that's watching, if you have other questions, please put them in there now. But one that came up, and Patrick, hopefully, Jeremy, you understand what Patrick is telling us. But he said he comes from a commodity background himself, and he's wondering if BNP actually gets involved with physical trading, or is it all paper? And I'm not really sure what that means, but maybe you understand.
So one of the things I always tell traders is stay in your lane. And I'm not a commodities trader, so I don't want to veer too far out of the lane. I do believe that we exited the physical commodities business a few years ago, but it's certainly something I could follow up with my folks on the commodities desk to give a more specific answer.
Sure. I didn't know what that meant, so I'm.
Well, what I could tell you is when you transact with commodities, like people will buy oil and sell oil, but at the end, you're actually buying a barrel of oil and you need to accept or deliver that oil. And that's a whole, and
again, I see. That makes sense.
It actually links in well to something I said earlier, which is like, you know, a commodities trader that deals in physical delivery of oil is also a trader. But their skill set is completely different because it has to do with logistics. Like if you buy a barrel of oil for $10 and you could sell it for $90, but it requires you to drive to California, then that's a logistical problem. So you've made, you know, $80 trading, but it may have cost you the
No, I really learned a lot there. And Patrick seemed like you're right on. He said, thank you. And then he said, exactly. So you're speaking the right language apparently, but I learned a lot there too. So thanks. All right. So I think we kind of mentioned this, but Anderson was asking about any other kind of West Coast options. Do you have anything over in the West Coast yet?
We do have presence in San Francisco within our global banking group. I'm not sure that we have anything open in the moment, but again, always happy to connect people with our stakeholders out there. I believe specifically within corporate credit, but we're growing. So I'm really excited for the future. I would love to see an LA office, and continue to expand in the States. They're keeping us in talent pretty busy. So hopefully something in the future.
Great. That's good. So we're getting on over 40 minutes now. So I kind of wanted to give you both an opportunity to say or give us your insight on if I really want to get myself into BNP and I'm a transitioning service member or a military spouse for sure. You know, what's your advice for them? Maybe, you know, first steps or things to consider, or, you know, places to go or things to do.
Well, first things first, I definitely encourage everyone to connect with both Jeremy and I on LinkedIn. I welcome and would love to, you know, connect, have an exploratory conversation, learn a little bit more about your background, see your resume, provide any advice, and, you know, learn about what you'd like to do. And then, you know, join our talent community. Again, it's a way for you to share your resume that, you know, is circulated throughout other areas in the firm, not just, you know, within talent acquisition, and connect with some of our members of our military employee resource group, which will also give you insight as to the culture, right? It's a two-way street. There's got to be that synergy. And I think, you know, by submitting your resume either to me directly via LinkedIn or via email, I know my information will be circulated after the event, or through that link to our talent community. You know, we're happy to give you some more insight as to what roles we have open, what's to come, and then introduce you to, you know, certain people that could really help be a champion for, you know, your skill set and what role you're looking to get into.
Thank you. That's huge that you personally will, you know, help people guide them through the best ways to fit into the company. I appreciate it. Jeremy, what do you think? What's your advice?
I think that in our industry, I mean, look, I would love for everybody to come to BNP, but as Lena mentioned, it's a two-way street. So all the things that we talked about in terms of culture or my specific role, it's not gonna resonate with everybody. But generally speaking, you know, in terms of getting into our industry, we like people that are aggressive. We like people that are, you know, that take initiative and follow up. You know, I know some of you have already reached out in LinkedIn. I have to tell you that, you know, I probably receive something in the magnitude of, you know, 5 requests per day and another 5 emails per day. So the likelihood of me, you know, writing back or finding time or something is relatively low. So you have to kind of, you know, widen your net as far as you can. Look for other contacts at BNP that you can connect with. You know, go through the HR channels, which are typically more responsive. One thing that I would be happy to host is if you want to have a follow-up to do a deeper dive, you know, we could certainly do a smaller group, or we can do a little bit more interactive. I'd be happy to.
That's a great idea. Yeah, I might take you up on that, Jeremy. So everyone out there listening.
Actually, I would like Jennifer to host because
she's probably a lot better than I am, for sure. but got lucky there.
But joking aside, I mean, I do... You know, I think if you send a single email to a bank or a fund or whoever, and they don't get back to you, you know, that's not the fund's fault or the bank's fault. That's on you. You know, I don't think, you know, there's a line, obviously, and it's crossable. But I always tell people, I'd rather you cross the line and be too annoying than not, you know, not follow up enough. Because
Think it's a good idea as far as even kind of extending that to a networking conversation, right? Even if it's finding people that work there and try to link in with them on LinkedIn and just say, hey, I'm thinking about this. Do you have any time to give me some advice? And I think a lot of people are willing to have that conversation. But you know what's been bugging me for the last 45 minutes, Jeremy, is I didn't get a chance to guess what you went to Cornell for. Think I got it. I know Cornell has a big food science department. So food science.
It's close. It's close. I'll give you most credit, most of the credit, but not 100. So I went to the School of Hotel Administration, which is the hospitality degree.
And you're a trader now.
And I'm a trader now.
Okay.
So it's interesting because in the early parts of my career, you know, I said I went to Cornell. And the leap would be to people would think you were a math and engineering major. And actually, of all the desks to be a head trader of, I actually trade on one of the more technical savvy desks. despite the fact that my technical skills are probably as low as anybody on the platform. So how is that possible, right? And the reason it's possible is because I have hired people with, you know, A++ technical skills. So, you know, having a team that's complementary, and that's what I was talking about, diversity before. You know, I know it's become, somehow it's become a politicized word, but, you know, diversity isn't only, you know, gender and ethnicity. I mean, I make a joke that when I joined BNP, I didn't realize soccer was such a popular sport. I mean, they remind me every day it's the biggest, it's the most popular sport on the world. And yet for me, it's like watching grass grow. But, you know, actually celebrating, sorry, Lena, celebrating that diversity is something that makes our teams even stronger. You know, me teaching the rules of baseball to my French counterparts, them teaching the rules of soccer to me is exactly the same as me using my strong hospitality skills to build a client franchise and, you know, to network, as their technical skills are there to make sure that, you know, we're automating and industrializing.
Oh, yeah, that's really a good point. And I'll tell you, for some reason, almost everybody I met there plays tennis. And I know that you all sponsor a big tennis tournament as well. There was one more question that came in. I want to try to squeeze it in real quick. And I think this has to go to training, right? So the question was from Hardy that says, does BNP pay for Series 65 or others? And I think that has to do with kind of your qualifications to be certain positions in the banking world. Is that true?
Absolutely. We will. Yeah. When you get hired for a role, there will be certain requirements, and either you, you know, if you have them going in, that's great. But if you don't have them, there'll be a period of time where you're given an opportunity to study and then take and it will eventually pass the different exams that are necessary to do your job.
Great. All right. So I really want to appreciate and tell you that this was really great. I learned a lot myself. I think our community learned a lot, not only about, you know, training, but also what a great place BNP would be to potentially work. So thank you both for your time today and be willing and your willingness to communicate with people after this fact. So thank you for that. And I really appreciate having you here today. And I give you a last word.
Yeah, I just want to remind everybody that I hope that this was some, you know, some good insight into what it takes to be a trader. I hope it changed your perspective on things a little bit. But first and foremost, I just want to say thank you for your service. Thank you for protecting our country. Thank you for keeping us safe. And, you know, anything we can do, I can do personally, the BNP team or the greater community. I know that there is a big push to hire military into the financial services world. Don't be ashamed to use it to your advantage. It's something that you've worked hard to build. And definitely use it in any way you can to get yourself in the industry, because as we said earlier, whether you know it or not, so many of the skills that you learned in the military are you know, transferable to the things we do on our desks. So thank you from me to and everybody at the BNP family.
Again, thanks both. Everyone, check out this again. We can watch it many times afterward, as many times as you want after on LinkedIn, and stay tuned for our another one of these inside looks next week. So thanks again, everybody. Have a great day.
Thanks, everyone. Thanks for having us.
Thanks for having us.